initiative of my colleague Gavin Arnold from the Marketing Business Student Society Forum and myself, Adela Pineda. So we thank you for being here. And we thought that on the occasion of the bicentennial of Marx's birth, and thinking about the central theme of the convention this year, textual transactions, I think, you know, the transaction word like resonated. So we thought of revisiting Marx's thought, the many versions of Marxism, by, as Gavin said, deprovincializing it and taking the lens of Mexico, taking the advantage of the Mexican case as a vantage point to actually don't read Marx from continental theory. So we thought of several themes. How can we reapply the lesson of Mexican history back onto Marx and Marxism by exploring certain topics? For example, the community-commune divide that characterizes Bruno Bustin's research, some of his research, or the importance of the relationship between communal, regional, and national interests that also was an important topic that Marx explored when thinking of the future of agrarian communities after the Russian Revolution. How can we reread Marx's thought on this topic by looking into the Mexican case after the Mexican Revolution? Or how can we think of the relationship between political cultures and intellectual thought by reading lesser known Marxists, and mainly those heterodox ones who come from the Latin American tradition? You know, we all know Mariátegui, but you know, there are Mexican thinkers that have been not so widely read, no? Like González Rojo. So those are kind of like some of the topics that we would like to address and then open up the conversation with you. And I would now give the word to my colleague Gavin, who is going to introduce the panelists and maybe tell you more about the podcast.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for being here. It's really a pleasure. I want to thank Adela particularly for initiating this exchange between the two committees, and also for the panelists who traveled to be here. I'm going to be reading their bios, each of them, and then we'll go in order of the bios that I read for about 15 or 20 minutes each presentation, and that should give us plenty of time for discussion before the session. So we begin with Bruno Bastiles, who is a professor in the Department of Latin American and Iberian Cultures for the joint appointment at the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society at Columbia University. He's the author of works such as The Actuality of Communism and Marx and Freud in Latin America, both with Verso, and the translator or editor of several books by Alain Badiou, including Can Politics Be Thought, which was released just a few days ago with Duke University Press. Next, we'll have Yvonne Del Valle, who's Associate Professor of Colonial Studies at UC Berkeley. Her research and teaching make connections between the past and the present to show the relevance of the colonial period for an understanding of contemporary times. She has written on Jesuits such as Loyola and Acosta, and water management in Mexico City. Her book, Escribiendo desde los Márgenes, was published with Siglo XXI in 2009. And finally, we have Jaime Ortega, who's a professor at the Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana Xochimilco. He has edited several volumes on Marxist thought and Latin American philosophy, and is the author of Leer el Capital, Teorizar la Política, Contrapunteo de la Obra de Enrique Lucha y Bolívar Echeverría, which was published with UNAM in 2018. So please join me in welcoming us.
We all know, even if only by hearsay, about the blatantly racist nature of the young Karl Marx's comments about Mexicans in a personal letter to Friedrich Engels. Especially toward the end of his life, however, the author of Das Kapital also began to show a keen interest in the types of collective property democratic social organization and communal existence found among the Aztecs, alongside with a similar interest in the primitive communism of the Incas. This is most often lost on those European readers who to this day remain obsessed with the heroic example and defeat of the 1871 Paris Commune. But if we put together Marx's comments on the economic forms that precede capitalism, to use the title of a section from the Grundrisse, also published as a separate booklet with a preface by Eric Hobsbawm, as well as his excerpts and annotations on the structure and principles of the Aztec social system, to use an expression from Lewis Morgan's book, Ancient Society, as transcribed by Marx between 1880 and 1881, as part of what would come to be known as his ethnological notebooks, the question inevitably arises as to the possible relation between what we might call the political form of the commune on the one hand and the anthropological form of the community or communal being on the other. In the Grundrisse, Marx borrowed much of this terminology to describe this relation from Hegel's logic of the positing of the presuppositions, which allowed him to speak of a strange loop whereby capital, while destroying the so-called primitive communities that actually existed before its arrival, nonetheless lived the effective conditions of its becoming at the level of a fundamental fantasy, as if they were the results of its own being. The question that I want to raise in the following minutes, by contrast, is whether the communities that were so violently torn asunder and overlaid with new modes of production in the process of colonization, beginning in the case of Mexico with the conquest of Tenochtitlan, can also rise up in communal forms of revolt and insurrection without necessarily having to follow the same twisted path of the now dominant theory of the modern subject, who, like an eternal Munchausen, continues to pull himself up from his own hair. In order to answer this last question, after starting out from the few explicit remarks made by Marx about the structure of Aztec society, I will try to reapply the historical lessons of Mexico's past back onto the meaning of Marx's legacy. Ultimately, however, the aim of these reflections is meant to be practical, not merely philological. What matters are not just questions of textual exegesis about the past, but their repercussions for our understanding of current and perhaps future forms of political practice. As for the two halves of my title, I should note that neither one is entirely my own creation. Similar investigations already appeared several years ago with nearly identical titles. Thus, in 1939, under then-President Lázaro Cárdenas, Domingo P. de Toledo, according to Gastón García Cantú, a pseudonym for the Cuban writer José Antonio Fernández de Castro, edited and introduced a handy brochure called Mexico en la obra de Marx y Engels, published by the offices of the PRI, containing a limited selection of fragments from personal letters, major works, and newspaper articles in which Marx and Engels mention aspects of the history of Mexico, most of them referring either to the U.S. intervention in 1847 or to the attempt between 1861 and 63 of the French, in cahoots with the British and the Spanish, to install Maximilian of Habsburg as emperor. Conversely, in 1972, when Luis Echeverría was president, José Porfirio Miranda published a short book titled Marx en México, Plusvalía y Política, in which he draws on the main lessons from the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte in order to argue that the bourgeoisie in Mexico too had finally learned that it was preferable for the ruling class not to rule directly, but rather to leave the government in the hands of a professional elite as its puppet or buffer. What neither of these authors could have known at the time of their writing, however, is the extent to which Marx's interest in Mexico was far from being limited to the post-independence period, and in fact harkened all the way back to the structure of Mesoamerican society in pre-Cortesian times. Now, to anticipate my argument, all I want to say in a sense can be summed up in the possible link between two seemingly unrelated statements. The first, drawn from the indigenous accounts of the conquest of Tenochtitlan, as recounted in book 12 of Bernardino de Sahagún's General History of the Things of New Spain, refers to the historic moment in August of 1521 when the Spaniards butchered countless inhabitants who were celebrating the festivities of Huitzilopochtli. And I quote, just a small fragment from chapter 20 in book 12. Those who ran into the communal houses were safe for a while, so were those who lay down among the victims and pretended to be dead. The second statement is a rhetorical question drawn from the beginning of Marx's account of the 1871 Paris Commune in the Civil War in France, and reads simply as follows. What is the commune that Sphinx so tantalizing to the bourgeois mind? Now, in the existing scholarship, there exists apparently no link between these two statements, separated by more than three centuries. And an unfortunate division of labor continues to this day between, on the one hand, Marxist philosophers and theorists such as Alain Badiou, who enthusiastically speaks about the Paris Commune, but considers any talk of the pre-modern commune an example of primitive communism in the pejorative sense. And on the other hand, Marxist anthropologists such as Maurice Godelier, another ex-Althusserian, or Lawrence Crater, the editor of the Ethnological Notebooks of Karl Marx, who comment at length on the primitive communities or the agrarian communes without envisaging the leap to the commune as what Marx would later call an expansive political form. Yet, there is a clear link, and this is my fundamental thesis. Marx, between the Grundrisse and his final ethnological notebooks in the 1880s, was coming closer and closer to it. The commune will continue to be an enigmatic sphinx as long as we do not grasp its underground links to the so-called primitive communities, until now studied almost exclusively by anthropologists and ethnographers. So let me give three quick steps in this argument for such a link. First, with regard to matters of terminology, the term translated in the first statement as communal houses in the original Nahuatl was calpulco, which Sahagún originally translated as capillas de los cuis. But in the new retranslation directed from Nahuatl by Ángel María Garibay in 1956, it's translated as la casa común or las casas comunes o comunales. For example, y los españoles andaban por doquiera en busca de las casas de la comunidad. Por doquiera lanzaban estocadas, buscaban cosas, por si alguno estaba oculto ahí. Por doquiera anduvieron, todo lo escudriñaron, en las casas comunales por todas partes rebuscaron. In English, the Spaniards ran into the communal houses to kill those who were hiding. They ran everywhere and searched everywhere. They invaded every room, hunting and killing. Thus, in Sahagún's account of the conquest of Tenochtitlan, we can already hear foretold the whole subsequent history of colonization as an ongoing process of destruction of the common or the commune, provided that we translate the Nahuatl term calpulco not as capillas or templos, as Sahagún originally did in good Christian fashion, but as casas comunes or comunales, the communal houses, that is, those buildings reserved for the gathering or assembly, whether religious or not, of the calpuli, which in its turn, instead of as wards or neighborhoods, as barrio or vecindario, we might risk understanding as comuna, the real or mythical birthplace of so many future comunero uprisings and revolts. Now, Marx, for the longest time, was supposed not to have gone beyond his journalistic writings about the US invasion of Mexico, published in the New York Daily Tribune and in Die Presse, or the French campaign of Louis Bonaparte with Maximilian. But with the discovery of the ethnological notebooks, this opinion no longer holds up. It is clear that Marx knew and read a lot about Mexico and its Aztec past. He instructed Engels, for example, to use his notebooks about Louis Morgan, which I will say a little bit more in a minute, to write on the origin of the family, the state, and private property. Where, contrary to what happens in the Grundrisse, the reference to the Aztecs vastly outnumbered those to the Incas. Now, most of these notebooks are excerpts from Lewis Morgan's 1877 book Ancient Society, which includes a chapter on the Aztec Confederacy. So we have a full 10 pages of Marx or Morgan writing on Tenochtitlan, on Tlatelolco, on Moctezuma, with secondhand quotes not just from Prescott's History of the Conquest of Mexico, which Marx had already read in the 1840s and 1850s in the context of his newspaper articles, but also from an impressive range of chroniclers and historians of the conquest, Gómara, Durán, Herrera, Clavijero, Sahagún, as well as the indigenous accounts of Tezozómoc and Iztaccíhuatl, as well as an anonymous conqueror in Cortés' army, which Morgan quotes in French. Now, all These references are borrowed from Morgan, to be sure, but it is still exhilarating to read Marx writing in his personal notebooks about the pueblo or Altepetl of Tenochtitlan. Now, insofar, let me just give you two quotes of the transcripts, so the excerpts that Marx writes. The fascinating aspect about these notebooks is that they're written in something like German English, and there's nothing like Portuñol, you know. And without marking what he quotes, he just translates some words into German, he passes back into English from Morgan's book, and adds translations or interpretations of the Nahua and Spanish words. One, commune tenure of lands, life in large households composed of a number of related families, und reasons for believing that they practice communism in living in the household. Two, the houses in Pueblo of Mexico were Zweifelzone, no, undoubtedly, in general, large communal or joint tenement houses. This is probably the best translation of Calpulco. Joint tenement houses, this is Morgan's term. We die in Neu Mexico, zur selben Period, period, groß genug zu akkommodieren von 10 bis 50 und 100 families in each. Or three, der Pueblo of Mexico, geografisch geteilt in four quarters, jedes occupied by a lineage, fratri, und jedes quarter subdivided, each subdivision occupied by a community of persons bound together by some common tie. Gents, this was Morgan's basic theory. This middle or superior period of barbarism, on the passage from savagery to barbarism and civilization, which was not meant to be a celebration of civilization, but rather an attempt to recapture the greatness and superiority of the middle period, in which he sort of puts together the Greeks, the Romans, and the Iroquois, together with the Tenochcas, as the possibility or promise for a return to those archaic democratic forms of council government or confederacy in superior forms. So Marx continues his annotation. So every quarter had several wards. He doesn't use the word Calpulli, but we're very close. According to the number of their gods, this idol called them to above. Nach dieser Partition, die sich injured dachten, mit kindred and followers went away to seek some other place, namely Tlatelolco, das in der Nähe. So when people felt injured, when they had agravios, they went to look for help in the neighboring, in the vicinities, for example, in Tlatelolco. Marx writing about Tlatelolco. Finally, he quotes from Clavijero. Auch die Landtenure sagt hin auf Gentes, the theory of the gens, the Gentile organization, not yet political, and not yet based on the family-oriented private property that would lead, according to Morgan, to the overwhelming power of a monarchy. Clavijero sagt, the lands called Altepetlali, Marx adds, Altepetl equals pueblo, that is, those of the communities of cities and villages were divided into as many parts as there were districts in a city, and every city possessed its own part entirely distinct from and independent of every other. These lands could not be alienated by any means whatsoever. This is the primitive communism in the living that Marx wants to recapture, also possibly among the Aztecs. And so in his first draft of a famous letter to Vera Sasulich, who from the Russian populist side was asking the same questions about the role of the agrarian commune in the passage to socialism and communism, Marx wrote, and I quote, in the words of an American writer, Morgan, who, supported in his work by the Washington government, is not at all to be suspected of revolutionary tendencies, the higher plane, or the new system to which modern society is tending, will be a revival in a superior form of an archaic social type. Now, and to conclude, this is exactly what happened in Mexico. However, even before invoking cases such as the Commune of Morelos or the first Zapatistas in 1914-1915, or the recent Commune of Oaxaca in 2006, we should recall that in 1520-21, the uprising of the Comunidades of Castile back in Spain was strictly contemporary with the conquest of Tenochtitlan, with the result that the Comunidades, for Don Quixote, but also later for the dictionary of the Real Academia, Academia Española, will have as one of its meanings that of levantamientos, or uprisings, the kind that the Spanish conquerors of Tlatelolco and other parts of Tenochtitlan wanted to avoid at all costs. So here, there's not even a need to find a link between the communities and the political commune, since the communities already are the revolt, or the rising up of the commune, or the Calpulli. Now, 1877, the year Morgan's major work was published, is also the year of a massive strike in Erie, Pennsylvania, in the US. In the mainstream media, this was often attributed to foreign agitators inspired by the Paris Commune. But still, in the same year, the Greek Mormons, Spinozists, and utopian socialists, in the style of Fourier, Plotino Radocanati, as I discussed elsewhere, published a column in the Mexican newspaper El Combate, in which he announced that the Commune would also reach the Americas. He wrote, "Thus we believe that according to the infallible law of analogy, the Commune, which has been extinguished in Paris, at least in appearance, after germinating throughout Europe and transmigrating to the United States of America, will not fail to visit us in a short while, like a migrating bird hovering above the corrupt villages, to purify them and to devour the tyrants that infest them." Now, students of Rodocanati's socialist school in Chalco would also contribute to the ideological formation of radical socialist, anti-authoritarian or libertarian communists, such as Julio López Chávez. And finally, some of these young pupils may in turn have influenced the rural teachers and ideologues who would surround revolutionaries such as Emiliano Zapata during the Mexican Revolution that began in 1910. I'm thinking, for example, of Otilia Montaño, you know, famous intellectual co-author of the Plan de Ayala, in which reference is made to returning to the communal system without further explanations, el sistema comunal, to govern the lands that were going to be reappropriated. But Zapata, in Jesús Otero Inclán's Raíz y Razón de Zapata, 1943, is also presented as a calpuleque, that is to say, as the leader of the calpulli. And I quote, the different mentions of the calpuleques of Anenecuilco, of which in 1909 Zapata was elected the principal, are so many links in a long chain that perhaps knew no interruption over the course of various centuries. Of course, many links are missing, but is it not amazing that so many concrete data about them would have been preserved? If from the most remote past they form a straight line that reaches all the way to Emiliano Zapata, we have good reason to say that he too was a calpuleque. We don't know, of course, what Marx's intentions were with his historical and ethnological investigation. We can only speculate and conjecture. But after the 1871 Paris Commune, to take up again the question of the primitive community of ancient societies such as the Aztecs, surely can be interpreted as an attempt to strengthen his overarching hypothesis that, given the appropriate circumstances, aspects of this archaic form of communism in living, as Marx called it after Morgan, could return and be revived in superior conditions. An underground history of these intermittent returns of the communist tradition in Mexico from pre-conquest times to the present is still waiting to be written. And as Morgan also suggested, in doing so, we are at liberty to commence anew and use the available information differently so as to bring together the enigmatic link between the anthropological community and the political commune that Sphinx so tantalizing to the bourgeois mind. Thank you.
Mami regañó Kevin porque no voy a hablar de Marx y voy a hablar en español, entonces voy a hablar del magonismo, ¿no? Y también quizás volviendo un poco el viejo debate entre el anarquismo y el comunismo, y aquí estoy presentando el anarquismo lingüístico. Ya se trata también de pensar para mí un poco la relación de lo que pudo haber sido el anarquismo mexicano, el maonismo, pero también vincularlo de manera indirecta aquí con el zapatismo como una forma también de comunismo. Entonces esto se llama comunismo, marxismo, question mark, preguntas, y la respuesta es magonismo. Recientemente leí un texto de Bruno Stills, La introducción al libro de Badiou, Can Politics Be Taught, donde aclaraba la postura marxista de este último, militancia y lucha real por sobre una fidelidad muerta, análisis y principios que para ser tales tienen que ajustarse a una realidad contingente. Esto no implica que el marxismo o el comunismo sean irreconocibles respecto de sí mismos o que queden vacíos de significados concretos y que todo debe ser marxismo sin marxismo. Se trata más bien de encontrar las soluciones que principios comunistas asumen en coyunturas específicas. Uno de estos momentos es la Revolución Mexicana y la relación de Ricardo Flores Magón y lo que él llama el anarquismo comunista, con la prolongada y cambiante lucha que se llevaba a cabo en tiempo real. Lo que sugiero aquí es pensar una de las dos direcciones más radicales de la revolución, la otra es el zapatismo, y las dos como proyectos comunistas. Precisamente por eso el nombre propio es un error. No se trata de Ricardo Flores Magón y tampoco del Partido Liberal, sino de las ideas, el compromiso de regeneración, parte de un aparato de guerra que no se agota tampoco en sus páginas impresas. El nombre es entonces preliminar, parte de un todo que tiene muchas aristas. Desde un principio la Revolución Mexicana estuvo dividida en dos grandes campos. Por un lado, la Revolución Triunfante, que fuera del gobierno de Lázaro Cárdenas, se diluyó una y otra vez en un reformismo insuficiente en el mejor de los casos y en el peor, en la negación absoluta de eso por lo que se había luchado. Por otro, está la verdadera revolución, la del villismo y el zapatismo, ya sea que se les considere juntos o de forma separada. El Partido Liberal y los Flores Magón pertenecerían a esta segunda opción, aunque nunca con la misma fuerza que los otros dos en el imaginario nacional. Para contrarrestar esta marginalidad, Claudio Lomnitz lo resitúa como posibilidades comunitarias internacionales. De uno y otro lado de la frontera aparecen los camaradas de Flores Magón, un grupo de hombres y mujeres, y Lomnitz hace una gran lectura de las mujeres en este grupo, lo cual no es una cosa menor. Este grupo, que independientemente de su clase social, sabe que las cosas tienen que cambiar y arriesgan todo para crear las condiciones para que el cambio ocurra. La Revolución Mexicana es aquí una parte central y sin embargo no lo es, no es todo. La lucha es internacional y no puede agotarse ni siquiera en eso que la origina y le da forma inicial. Dos cosas, sin embargo, atenúan la fuerza de la lectura del Lomnitz: el exceso de la biografía y la inflexión melancólica que atraviesa el grupo de Magón, visto como un Don Quijote, es una cita, claro, out of place, utopian, or more precisely, out of time. Aunque limitada a México, Osvaldo Zavala ofrece una lectura más decidida en la que sigue siendo el tiempo del magonismo. Para notarlo, habría que buscarlo no en su posible influencia entre quienes peleaban la revolución, o cómo se mide la influencia, sino como parte de la lucha misma, como realidad, pero también como continuidad contemporánea en la crítica disidente de la Revolución Triunfante. Por su parte, Cristina Heatherton recuerda que si el magonismo no hubiera representado una amenaza radical al status quo, no lo habrían perseguido en dos países durante tantos años. Los enemigos, después de todo, entienden lo que está en juego tanto como los compañeros con quienes se intenta construir algo nuevo. Quizás parece necio situar a Flores Magón en el contexto de la revolución en lugar de liberarlo para que ocupe otros espacios. Sin embargo, como él insistía, era y es importante no empequeñecer el significado o el alcance de la lucha armada. Por el contrario, hay que entenderle sus verdaderas dimensiones como una insistencia particularmente fuerte de posibilidades comunistas. Es decir, hay que insistir tanto en el contenido, anarquismo comunista, como en la escala del magonismo que pretendía tomar por asalto todo un país. Para iniciar precisamente con las dimensiones, un artículo de septiembre de 1910, El derecho a la rebelión, brevísimo texto que condensa el tipo de información que compartía Regeneración desde sus inicios en 1901. La concentración hace especialmente evidente una de sus funciones: servir de memoria y de lugar de unión de todas las luchas, luchas jurídicas de pueblos y personas particulares contra el abuso del gobierno, de la élite, luchas obreras por mejores condiciones de trabajo, huelgas, las de Cananea y Río Blanco, pero también muchas otras, rebeliones indígenas, las de los zapotecas por sus salinas comunales, la interminable de los yaquis, la pelea constante de muchos periodistas por la posibilidad de hablar críticamente de las condiciones del país, las de algunos políticos e incluso militares que, como muchos otros en la larga lista de Flores Magón, habían sido silenciados por el régimen porfirista. Sin embargo, no. Esto es precisamente la tarea de regeneración, hacer que pese a todo siguieran hablando, uniendo todas sus voces en una especie de estos somos o estos hemos venido siendo, la urgente conjunción de todo lo que parecía disperso pero no lo estaba. De esta diversidad surge una idea, un proyecto múltiple y quizás poco coordinado como la revolución misma, pero que pese a esto muestra que el conjunto de luchas había espacios de fuerte disenso y libertad capaz de romper quizás la superficie total del porfiriato y mucho más que eso, reventarlo desde dentro. Muestra también que la revolución empezó no con el llamado de Madero de 1910, sino mucho antes, en esas luchas dispersas y verdaderamente radicales para las que el objetivo de no reelección resultaba insuficiente. Había pues que sumar, expandir las bases, vincular al norte con el sur, a indígenas y comuneros con obreros y campesinos que podían o no ser indígenas, a políticos radicales con indígenas y con obreros, y también, aunque esto Flores Magón, a diferencia de lo mismo, lo hacen en vida, incorporar a las mujeres que de una u otra forma no estuvieran ya activas en el movimiento. Ninguna otra publicación revolucionaria hizo esto, o cuando menos no tan temprano. Cuando los manifiestos zapatistas incluyen un espectro de lucha que rebasa con mucho el entorno campesino, lo hacen en gran parte por haberlo aprendido de regeneración. Aunque los dos proyectos no exijan exactamente lo mismo, su cercanía es clara en el ofrecimiento de Zapata de publicar el periódico magonista con papel de la fábrica San Rafael, expropiada y trabajada por el Ejército del Sur. Campesinos en control de la producción de papel en lo que Adolfo Gili llama la Comuna de Morelos, leyendo a otros revolucionarios en el exilio, mientras estos se dedicaban a republicar manifiestos zapatistas y explicar su radicalidad y defenderlos de los ataques de Carranza, es una muestra también de la coherencia de un movimiento que tenía claro el enemigo común y por ello la lucha común, independientemente de la afiliación étnica, laboral y de género de los combatientes. El objetivo era refundarlo todo. Y esto, entre otras cosas, es precisamente lo que ofrecía Regeneración desde sus inicios. En este sentido, Zavala tiene razón. Las palabras no son solo palabras, sino la realidad de la lucha y cómo éstas eran capaces de conectar a los que en ella participaban, pero también de abrir surcos, estas son palabras de Magón, surcos definitivos en el enemigo. Y ahora voy a hablar un poco sobre lo que es el anarquismo para mí en Magón, y sé que lo estoy leyendo de una manera muy particular que después lo podemos discutir porque no es eso el anarquismo, ¿no? Las lecturas de Flores Magón, de Kropotkin, Bakunin, Ferrer son conocidas. Vale la pena en todo caso no dar nada por hecho y ver qué es lo que implica el anarquismo mexicano en tanto tal anarquismo, aunque este aspecto de su propuesta sea sin duda universal. Su primer compromiso es destruir lo que debía ser destruido. La así llamada paz porfiriana, por ejemplo, esa paz, insistía, no valía la pena y hacía de quienes la asumían lo predicaban cobardes, criminales incluso. Esta decisión por la violencia es supuestamente una de las cuestiones que marginalizan al magonismo. Y puesto que también el villismo y el zapatismo optaron por la violencia, hay que pensar que la necesidad de responder a la fuerza con la fuerza del magonismo tiene un alcance expansivo. Va más allá del régimen de Díaz, una forma histórica particular de aquello que no debía de ser ni en el México de fines del siglo XIX ni en ningún otro tiempo y lugar. Es decir, la necesidad de la violencia permanece siempre que existan las condiciones que la vuelven conclusión lógica que debe permanecer desligada de todo sentimentalismo. Lo que en última instancia, que es la primera en realidad, había que destruir era la propiedad privada, y en esto, claro, el porfiriato es solamente una instancia de eso. Por la tierra es de todos, dice Flores Magón, cito, la propiedad territorial se basa en el crimen y por lo mismo es una institución inmoral, fin de la cita. Hecho simple, básico y sin embargo de una complejidad avasalladora, porque para hacerlo posible era necesario un enorme entramado que abarcaba la sociedad en su totalidad. Porque para cuidar esta propiedad es que existían las leyes y todo su aparato. Por ella, cito, se hacen necesarios el ejército, la judicatura, el parlamento, la policía, el presidio, el cadalso, la iglesia, el gobierno, y un enjambre de empleados y zánganos, y Flores Magón no dice la universidad, pero creo que la pondría en algunas veces, ¿no? Es decir, toda institución se agotaba en sus fines últimos, sostener la explotación. Para el magonismo no hay compromiso posible con instituciones semejantes. En esto, esto lo salto. Bueno, ahora vamos a... Ajá. Igualmente importante era la necesidad de insistir, de repetir la tarea y de dirigirse de forma diferenciada a distintos sectores de la sociedad, obreros, mujeres, etc. Puesto que las instituciones existentes tenían una función fundamental, era absolutamente predecible que esta función apareciera normalizada a nivel del individuo mismo. La inteligencia humana, dice Magón, estaba ya moldeada para aceptar la situación prevalente. Por eso había que recordarse lo que estaba en juego. Es eso lo que hace Flores Magón a lo largo de la lucha armada, decir una y otra vez que los objetivos de Madera no eran los de la revolución, como tampoco lo eran los de Carranza. Para evitar la confusión y el desánimo, había que saber cuál era el papel histórico que cada uno debía asumir y entender con ello la importancia fundamental de la clase trabajadora, obrera, campesina, los verdaderos productores de la riqueza social y, por lo tanto, los encargados de decidir sobre el destino de una rebelión que no podía contentarse con soluciones a medias. La fuerza de la clase trabajadora podía ser absoluta y, sin embargo, debido a la prolongada lucha, ¿no?, la revolución y sus elevados e innegables costos, había que recordar el carácter necesario de la destrucción total del viejo régimen, como hace en 1915, y esta es una cita. Destruyendo se construye, sin la violencia el pensamiento revolucionario sería estéril. Se quería todo y se quería ya, y precisamente por esto era necesario continuar luchando, no terminar hasta que de verdad se hubiera terminado. Cualquier otra cosa habría sido empequeñecer el movimiento, negar su verdadero cometido. Y ahora esta parte es comunismo. En 1910, un día antes de la fecha inicial del inicio de la revolución, Flores Magón, en su llamado a la rebelión, pedía a quienes iban a sumarse que entendieran la gravedad del contexto. Esperando que la violencia que se aproximaba no se aglutinara en torno a la falsedad de Madero, pero entendiendo también que aún era pronto para saber cómo iba a definirse lo que en principio era pureza destructora, dice, cito, no es posible predecir hasta dónde llegarán las reivindicaciones populares de la revolución. Fin de la cita. En 1915 indica, en cambio, que la dirección de lo disgregado era claro incluso para el campo enemigo, comunismo. Un comunismo anarquista que quería destruir la totalidad del sistema económico y político y que no iba a conformarse con nada que no fuera precisamente esto. Tanto como los zapatistas, aunque de un modo distinto, el magonismo reconoce que el hecho de que la tierra pudiera parcelarse y volverse propiedad privada era el problema. De nuevo, la tierra y todo lo que había en ella era de todos. Como efecto dominó, una vez derrumbado el fundamento del sistema económico, todo lo demás se vendría a las viejas leyes, las caducas instituciones, nada de esto tendría más razón de ser. Igual que el zapatismo, el magonismo tiene claro que ningún cambio serviría de nada a quienes peleaban la verdadera revolución si esto no iba acompañado, presidido de hecho por la libertad económica. Y esta libertad económica, este tomar posesión de la tierra y de todos sus bienes, tenía que hacerse contra la ley, rompiéndola y pasando por encima de ella, porque nunca había permiso para algo así. Ese comunismo por venir, sin embargo, haría que ciencia, saber y prácticas ya presentes, pero consideradas heréticas, cita a Galileo y a Bruno, por ejemplo, asumieran un lugar central. Lo menor, ciencia, cultura, se acercarían a participantes igualmente menores. La destrucción se hacía entonces a nombre, sí, de comodidades materiales, pero también de aspectos intelectuales y culturales reservados para la élite. Los derechos de la clase trabajadora eran muchos, dice, mucho más que los reconocidos en cualquier constitución. Desde la tierra entonces, con sus metales, y estas son palabras de él, con sus metales, sus árboles, carbón, tierra, cal, arena, sus ganados, incluso con el lujo, que a partir de esto, todo esto se producía en los trabajadores, todo insiste para todos por igual. Es decir, no era suficiente con tomar por la fuerza la tierra misma, se quería mucho más. O mejor, tomar la tierra significaba al mismo tiempo tomar el arte, la cultura, la música. El vocabulario de Flores Magón se vuelve opaco respecto al alcance o la forma del comunismo. No hay planes o formas específicas. ¿Cómo se verían las nuevas agrupaciones que ocuparían el lugar de las antiguas? No es claro. En su lugar, imágenes extremadamente sencillas. La vida, dice, el derecho a vivir. Y este derecho es representado por una mariposa que rompe el capullo que la aprisiona, de una semilla que en el surco agrieta la tierra para alcanzar el sol, una corteza que revienta. Habla también de felicidad y relaciona sin explicación todas estas cosas, ¿no? Vida, rebeldía, felicidad. La imprecisión de palabras tan extrañas desarma. Como si fuera evidente, lo porvenir tendría que dar a la mariposa y a la semilla lo que da suyo su forma natural, de la misma manera que la revolución, otra forma de erupción, tenía que dar al hombre lo que le era propio, propio y común. Y sin embargo, esto no estaba del todo determinado, puesto que más allá de la liberación, el futuro inmediato era tan arriesgado como desconocido. Quizás lo que antes llamé el exceso biográfico del trabajo del OVNI, solo es para mi gusto, tanto como el más reticente, pero igualmente personal de Heatherton, darle algunas pistas concretas sobre esta forma anárquica y comunista al mismo tiempo. En el segundo caso, porque Heatherton muestra cómo el paso de los Flores Magón por la prisión de Leavenworth constituyó un verdadero experimento comunitario de aprendizaje y acercamiento en varios idiomas, de ideas y colaboración entre presos políticos, presos comunes y líderes de movimientos disímiles que estuvieron ahí congregados. Esta comunidad fue forzada, sin embargo, a menos que se acepte que era precisamente la afinidad desconocida todavía lo que los lleva a congregarse en la prisión, como si el Estado supiera mejor que ellos mismos dónde radicaba su igualdad revolucionaria. Pero precisamente por su carácter forzado implicaba también una forma radical de devolver al hombre lo que era suyo y en la forma correcta, verdaderamente comunitaria de esas condiciones. Por su parte, el detallado estudio del OVNIS presenta la vida cotidiana del grupo magonista que compartía no solo casa, mesa, los importantes recursos económicos, sino también el trabajo, la responsabilidad, la lucha. En este caso también, es forzado, por lo menos en parte. Pese a esto, como indica el mismo Flores Magón, en 1910, ante la avalancha que se avecina, imposible saber la forma exacta de algo que todavía no es, ¿no?, el comunismo, o que tal vez ha sido ya múltiples veces bajo la forma de experimentos contingentes y forzados, pero reales.
Buenas tardes, voy a seguir con el anarquismo que inició nuestra compañera. Igual en inglés, aunque no es lo mejor lengua para mí, pero espero pueda comunicarles algo. El purpose of this text is to analyze the three moments in which Enrique González Rojo has strengthened the critique of Mexican political culture. González Rojo is a writer, philosopher, and activist with a long history in the Mexican left. His work has included essays, poetry, as well as a body of academic work. But he has also been politically active as a militant of the Communist Party in the 50s, and as a founder of the Leninist Spartacus League and the Communist Spartacus League, as well as the Integral Revolution Group. He will also later participate in the funding of the Democratic Revolution Party. He was also university professor until the 1980s. This biography is complemented by a philosophical publication which began to appear in the 70s, amongst the most famous of which is Paralelo al Ser, or Epistemología y Socialismo, theoretical text of great weight. In the page that follow, I will make reference to what, to me, seem to be the tricky moments in the critique that González Rojo presents of Mexican political culture, through three historical figures: José Revueltas, Adolfo Sánchez Vázquez, and Octavio Paz. The first two, as is well known, are central figures in the Marxist and leftist tradition in Mexico. The third, the great Mexican writer of the 20th century, is a key cultural and literary figure. The choice of these three references in relation to the academic production of González Rojo enables me to substantiate the argument that his work represents a critical streak in 20th century Mexico. That is to say that a large part of the leftist of progressive tradition is played or through the way in which the work of this intellectual is analyzed. With Revueltas, González Rojo discussed the transition of the left in the first half of the 20th century and express the tension related to attempts at its renovation in the later half. With Sánchez Vázquez, he seals a score with a Marxist that belonged to the first half of the century and does not how to change its following the incursion of Althusser. Finally, in his critique of Paz, González Rojo reaffirmed his critique of dominant liberal culture and criticized its failure when faced by the onslaught of neoliberalism. The three critics, the speed, the distance, and difference between their objects have running through them what is Gonzalo Rojo's most important contribution. The theory that the intellectual class is a social group, intellectual class is a social group which makes use of the epistemological and technical means that enables its social reproduction. González Rojo's relationship with Revueltas has a long background, but followed the path of the resistance of power from the 15th onwards. They experienced the last stand of the most Stalinist period of the Communist Party, from which they were expelled. From the until the mid-70s, they coincided in political space, and later their paths separate. It was during this period that González Rojo wrote one of the two reviews on an essay of Revueltas' Headless Proletariat, which appeared in the important journal Politica in October 1962. This review caused him of criticism from the important intellectual Francisco López Cámara, with whom he maintained a brief debate of the page of the same journal. Over the next two decades, González Rojo was fine-tuning his own version of Marxism. He enters through the side street of theoretical Althusserianism and construct a class theory in which not only the bourgeoisie and the proletariat exist, but also intellectuals. It is from this viewpoint that in 1986 he publishes The Size of the Political Ideas of José Revueltas, in which he opts for a certain breaking away from the maestro. In this he argues a central issue. The reading that is carried out of Revueltas' thesis can be found even in the guidelines of the concept of a theory of the party, and of the political certainty that is possible and desirable. As is well known from the 15th onwards, Revueltas criticized all types of leftist organization, particularly the communists, for not being the vanguard, the brain, or the heat of the proletarian body, the true class party. All this appears once again in the size of the 1962, which is a key word from the Mexican left. For González Rojo, this position is mistaken, as he alludes to the problem of the intellectual class, in which the brain of the heat is a limited group of technocrats and politicians, in this case revolutionary, that guides the whole of the body. For González Rojo, this is the weakness in the Revueltas theory. He does not manage to see the power and domination logics that intellectuals reproduce over the hood of the working class. With this, González Rojo can be located within the Leninist tradition that Revueltas followed until 1968. Moreover, he enables other organizational forms to be conceptualized, such as those that call for self-management in Dismayan forms and takes emphasis away from the notion of the party as the only expression of political activity and consciousness among the subaltern class. It refers to, as we said at the beginning, a critic of the Marxists of the first half of the 20th century, which was totally committed to a supposed Leninist theory of the party, and whose genealogy can be found in the disputes between Stalin and Trotsky, amongst others. Nevertheless, González Rojo does not only direct criticism and Revueltas. In the same period, he concluded a long reading project of the work of Althusser, which began at the end of the 1968, when he rejected the premise of the French theories, once again in the page of the journal Politica. He would later find a useful line of analyzing work of the theorist, that of practice. This concept would enable him to argue that Althusser provides the beginning of a materialist theory of knowledge, in which the latter is considered a productivity act. Nevertheless, he criticized that Althusser does not complete the condition in which knowledge is produced, particularly those that relate to the class that embody this aspect, the intellectuals. At the same time, however, his critique does not prevent him from using and defending the work of Althusser. In this case, we refer to the book Epistemología y Socialismo, written with the purpose of responding to Sánchez Vázquez's critics in Ciencia y Revolución, Marxismo del Trucer. Epistemología y socialismo conjugates three levels of discourse. The critical presentation of the work of the Sánchez Vázquez, the presentation and critic of Althusser, and finally the presentation of his own theory. El libro de Sánchez Vázquez, Ciencia y Revolución, 120 páginas. La crítica de González Rojo, 500 páginas. Excesiva. Por esta razón. Let us concentrate on the critique that he makes of the Spanish-Mexican philosopher. He indicates that he was unable to understand the radical nature of Althusserianism, and therefore unable to overcome it. From González Rojo's point of view, the problem with Sánchez Vázquez is that he wants to restore the historicist coordinates that were in place period to the emergence of the work of the French theory. Specifically, he detects a shortcoming in the philosophy of praxis. It is incapacity to separate and explain the working of the theory and practice dichotomy, which is as the heart of its philosophy. In this way, in the work of Sánchez Vázquez, there is an error that he classifies as homologation, in which this dichotomy cannot be differentiated, neither in its operation nor in its working, resulting in the privileged position of practice, in undistinguished without level or nonsense, over and above that of theory. Commercially, in the work of Althusser, practice is a concept that works as a structure. There are mill production, basic material, and can be applied to mainland manifestations of the socialism. One of these is the theoretical. Theoretical production refers to the specific way in which knowledge operates. Beyond the nonsense, the definition and other critiques, what is most important is that González Rojo drops up a critique of the dominant Marxist current in the field of the philosophy. He does destroy the work of Althusser, whose go beyond this body of work, thus justifying a position that insists on theory as a specific field which cannot be reduced in the working of the other practice. Furthermore, he explained of the notion of the crisis of Marxism understood as the crisis of philosophy of praxis. González Rojo, he presents himself as one of two who are committed to renew critical discourse and go beyond the paradigms from the mid-20th century. Finally, González Rojo sharpens his critical tools when he considered the work of the gay figure, Octavio Paz. He does this in two texts. The king is naked, el rey va desnudo, and when the king becomes a cortesano, cuando el rey se vuelve cortesano. Although they are presented as a continuity, there are separate texts. The first is the transcription of a series of conferences and debates with a circle of students, in which González Rojo criticized the renowned poet characterization of the Soviet Union. The strength of this text is lost in the exchange and debates which followed, in which a maiden of scathing criticisms emerged. However, the criticism considered past lack of academic record when contemplating the state. The liberal criticism on the Soviet Union does not go far enough for González Rojo, when Paz don't manage to consider the existence of an intellectual class that took control of the technical means of social production. Es decir, las mismas críticas que a los dos anteriores. This text has more to say about González Rojo than about Paz, and for this reason is useful in understanding social nature in the face of position that is popularized in the mass media and through intellectual elites. The second test is much more suggestive. Published in 1919, it expressed Paz's surrender to neoliberalism. as well as providing a well-founded analysis of political and economic tendencies of government of Carlos Salinas. González Rojo takes on a harsh criticism of past justification of neoliberalism in relation to the way in which it hand over the nation's resources and sacrifices rich and the altar of the International Monetary Fund. He questioned whether past has given himself over to the neoliberal modernization discourse in the face of the alleged economic and political vagueness that the nationalist tradition produced. Alongside Aguilar Mora, Arnaldo Córdoba, and Dora Canusi, González Rojo was one of the leftist critics closer to past, nor in terms of poetry, nor in his behavior as a diplomat, nor in his tense relationship with the left, but rather in the exact moment in which the poet gave up all his freedom, independence, and autonomy in the name of the modernizing project that from its conception, electoral fraud, to its manifestation and forms, voted a new disaster dressed up as a modernizing, open and free market discourse. Here we have reviewed three critics that the Mexican intellectual direct towards state cultural figures. With Revueltas, as we say, he deconstruct Marxist-Leninist, using the theory of the party as a starting point. With Sánchez Vázquez, he expands on the concept of the desire for renovation that Althusser takes on, and he rebels against university Marxist's most important critical paradigm. With Paz, he outlines his conceptualization of the Soviet Union, but above all, he identifies the co-opting of the old critics by the project taken on by neoliberal shock. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much to our three speakers. I see kind of like several topics we could relate.